This is a Media Lab podcast. Welcome to Putting It Together, the podcast that goes through the entire body of work of Stephen Sondheim, show by show and song by song. My name is Kyle Marshall, your self-described Sondheim expert. You know, it's been a pretty eventful week. I published last week's episode, brushed my hands together, and was like, what a great day for podcasts and democracy. And then the rest of the day happened. And if you haven't looked at the news in the past week, hoo boy, you were in that for a surprise, but no spoilers here. I do need to address something that multiple people wrote to me about. So when I'm wrong, I am very wrong. In last week's episode, we were talking about the song Liaisons, and there's a lyric that reads, "What once was a rare champagne is now just an amiable hawk." And I mistakenly said that hawk referred to a piece of meat. Now, I remember that I was going to bring that up, but then didn't, about how I thought it was weird that Sondheim was comparing champagne to meat. You'd think he'd compare it to another drink. But that is what hock is. Per dictionary.com, hock is any white Rhine wine, otherwise cheap booze. Obviously, I know that now. Obviously, I know that that is what Sondheim meant. Now, in my defense, to push back a little bit, in my 37 years, I have never once heard anybody, other than in this song, I guess, refer to wine as hock. And, at least for me, dictionary.com, as its first definition is the joint in the hind leg of a horse, cow, etc. I also know hocks because I was served them growing up. They were like overly fatty, which I detest, and so begrudgingly choked them down when served to me, but did not enjoy the experience at all. However, let the record state that I, Kyle Marshall, am wrong, gloriously so, and please do not hesitate to correct me in the future. This is the most emails and messages I have ever received after an episode, and all of them essentially starting, "You idiot." So keep them coming. Now, if you'd like to try and get me smarter and support the show, you can always do that for free by rating and reviewing it on whatever podcast app that you use. Algorithms, you know, are a tricky thing, but it does help the show become more discoverable. Of course, if you'd like to help monetarily, which will also help make this show better and better and grow, you can go over to our Patreon page. Please do not donate if it impacts you negatively financially. Always a huge shout out to the God That's Good tier from Patreon, the Triumphant Quartet, Jack, Todd, Barry, and Carrie over there helping me out. And now it's time for Plodding Along. Plodding Along is the part of the show where I tell you what is happening in the plot. Frederick has gone to see his old flame, Desiree. During Liaisons, they had sex, and now after the act has finished, it's time for a bit of pillow talk. But that is when Carl Magnus, the man Desiree has been seeing as his mistress, arrives ready for some ravishing. He meets Frederick in a state of undress. Frederick and Desiree make up this story that Frederick is her lawyer who came to get her to sign some papers and then tripped and slipped into a hip bath. Wanting evidence, Desiree rushes into the other room and dunks Frederick's clothes in the water, and Carl Magnus makes Frederick walk home in his nightshirt carrying his sopping clothes. Meanwhile, he storms off to complain to his wife about his state of affairs. Let me go thank some sponsors, and then when we return, it'll be me talking about In Praise of Women with Adrianna Boris. Putting It Together is a proud member of the Alberta Podcast Network, locally grown, community supported. The Alberta Podcast Network promotes and supports Alberta-made podcasts and connects their audiences with Alberta-based businesses and organizations. This episode is brought to you by Park Power, a provider of electricity and natural gas in Alberta that offers low rates, awesome service, and profit sharing with local charities. In Alberta, you get to choose who to buy your energy from. If you choose Park Power, your money stays here. Plus, Park Power shares its profits with local not-for-profits that are working to make a difference for their communities. Shopping local is very important to Park Power's owner, Chris Kozowski, and we love local here at the Alberta Podcast Network, so it's a great fit. Learn more at parkpower.ca. This week, we're also brought to you by the Alberta Podcast Network, so let's go and listen to one of our other great shows.
The show you're listening to is part of the Alberta Podcast Network. locally grown, community supported. Another show from the network that you should check out is Repodcasting. Have you ever watched a movie and there was an actor in it that was all wrong for the part they were playing? Have you ever wanted to imagine someone else in the role? Never fear, that's precisely why Repodcasting exists. Listen as co-hosts and cousins Janet and Lucia recast their favorite and not-so-favorite movies with their dream cast. They also take a moment each episode to imagine which role in the film should have been given to Tony Danza, because let's face it, Tony Danza would make every movie better. You can find Repodcasting wherever you listen to podcasts or at albertapodcastnetwork.com. Happy listening!
She wouldn't, therefore they didn't. So then it wasn't, not unless it would he. She doesn't, God knows she needn't, therefore it's not.
Adrianna, thank you so much for coming back here again.
Thanks for having me.
You know, you've been here a few times here, of course, so we've heard your history with like Sondheim and your love of musical theater. I want to know specifically about your times seeing A Little Night Music on Broadway.
Yeah, so I saw the 2009 revival two or three times. Well, not with the original cast. I did not see Catherine Zeta-Jones and Angela Lansbury. I saw it with Bernadette Peters and Elaine Stritch. Like, I got like student rush tickets all three times. And
I mean, honestly, if you had to settle for seeing the show, I'll take Bernadette Peters and Elaine Stritch.
Oh, damn. <Yeah. laughs> But I actually ended up front row center the first time that I saw it. So I got like Bernadette Peters spit on me. Which is beautiful. But it was really amazing to see. It was the first time I'd seen the show ever. And I was already like somewhat familiar with the music at the time. I'd been working on a couple of songs from it, from the show, for various musical theater classes in college. Mm-hmm. But like seeing the two of them in those parts was absolutely phenomenal.
If you can remember going back to like that first performance that you got to go and see, like, do you remember what your thought process was? Because I feel like this is kind of a weird show to go in a bit cold with, to be like, oh, what is going on in this show?
Yeah, so I did, like I said, I listened to some of the music, but I wasn't, you know, completely familiar with it. So at first, it did kind of take me a second to kind of wrap my head around what was happening. But what was helpful, and I think Sondheim talks about this in Finishing the Hat, was the kind of like the Greek drama like unity that they use, where it's all over the course of the one weekend, and there's kind of the Greek chorus kind of setup that they have going on. So like the first couple of numbers where I'm like, why are all of these random people waltzing around singing?
Yeah.
Something that seems to be unrelated to what's going on. But I kind of put that together and was like, oh, okay, this is what we're doing.
Do you remember anything about like the staging, set design, that sort of thing? I can't remember if this one was like the minimal version or if there was like more of elaborate sets going on.
I remember it. I think it was pretty minimal. Because the house it was, I don't remember what theater it was in, but it was one of the smaller ones.
Yeah.
So the set, they did have set pieces, like in the scene where Desiree's doing the play, there was a two-piece, like a two-level set, rather, with like a balcony on it. But it wasn't incredibly elaborate that I can remember. Again, this was almost, this is over 10 years ago now, I guess. But
right.
but no, I don't think it was incredibly elaborate. Which worked because there's always so much going on and changing and shifting.
Yeah, like really at the end of the day, because there's so much, I don't know, plot that you have to go through. So you don't really have to spend a lot of time on like set design and stuff like that. The people are really what's
important.
Yeah,
and I think it's kind of the same with most of Sondheim's stuff is like, it's not a Cameron McIntosh production. You're not relying on the theatricality of it.
Yeah.
Because the music and the lyrics and the book usually kind of speak for themselves.
Mm-hmm. You know, now that it is like 10 years later, I guess, where do you rank this show in terms of like other Sondheim shows that you're familiar with?
Oh boy. I feel like I could have a bunch of different, like I could have a list for like favorite music and lyrics, or just like a list for favorite music, favorite lyrics, favorite productions I've seen, favorite productions to be in, favorite productions to sing in the shower. But I would like overall, I would put it up in the like top three or top five. it kind of also just depends on the mood. If I'm feeling a little bleak, you know, I'm going to listen to this and Follies in the same day probably. But if I'm feeling a little more chipper, I might pair this with Into the Woods, which I guess now that I say that is I wouldn't call Into the Woods chipper, but it's got more of an upbeat and message, more of a heartwarming feeling. I think it can kind of go either way there.
You know, over the past year, I can't imagine any day being bleak. So, you know, you must not have been listening to this very often.
In 2020, of course not. Absolutely not. Nothing bleak or grim here.
Well, today we get to talk about the song In Praise of Women. This is essentially the solo song from Carl Magnus. This is probably going to say more about me than I care to admit. Whenever they cast this role in this show, it's like the voice that I want to make love to, to be crass. I just love it. It's a very Gaston, like, I find in this case, where it's like very deep baritone usually is what they cast in this role.
Or the, like, Magaldi from Evita, the very, like, svelte, sexy, like,
While he sings a totally, like, misogynistic song. So it's going to be fun to talk about.
Right. It's like the old Scumbag Steve meme format from the early days of the internet.
Scumbag Steve Sondheim. That's what it's going to be.
Yeah.
Wearing that stupid hat backwards and everything. By the way, this probably has little to no relevance when this actually gets posted. But the musical The Prom just debuted on Netflix, like, yesterday, I think. On Netflix.
Mm-hmm, I watched it
last
night.
I'm halfway through. Mm-hmm. I actually was like, I watched it way too late last night. I'm like, I'm very tired. I can't make it through. So I'm like halfway through. But there's some good Sondheim jokes in it for people who want to watch that show. Yeah.
It's so good. And like Meryl Streep as not Patti LaBelle. Right,
exactly. It's Meryl Streep being Patti LaBelle, basically, in that one. Honestly, my only like major criticism at this point is I think James Corden is completely miscast, but everyone else is great. Yeah. Like, literally everyone else is great.
And like, I love James Corden, and he's a great actor, a great singer. He's so funny. He was just not right for that part. Like, especially in a show that's like its whole point is like queer visibility.
Yeah, it's a bit odd.
Famous straight man James Corden, but he was still enjoyable.
I'm right there. It's like this is turning into like a podcast about The Prom, but I've never been in a situation where I think the comedy beats are working, but the performance isn't for me. that's how I feel about him in that role. So, In Praise of Women. Carl Magnus. This is how it starts. As he kind of comes out, he's stewing about this meeting that he just had with Frederick and Desiree. And he says, "She wouldn't, therefore they didn't. So then it wasn't. Not unless it would she? She doesn't. God knows she needn't. Therefore it's not. He'd never, therefore they haven't. Which makes the question absolutely, could he? She daren't. Therefore I mustn't. What utter rot."
She wouldn't, therefore they didn't. So then it wasn't, not unless it would she. She doesn't, God knows she needn't. Therefore it's not. He never, therefore they haven't. Which makes the question absolutely, could she? She daren't, therefore I mustn't. What utter rot.
So just from that opening, anything that you want to call out?
I feel like he like just truly has like in no scenario in his mind is Desiree like her own person.
Right, I know, absolutely.
Like, with her own like thoughts and feelings and needs and desires, like she's a prop for him. And we kind of see that come up for both her and Charlotte throughout the show, where like they're not people. Like, he literally just does not see these women in particular, but I'm assuming all women because it's him, as humans.
it's
which is just real gross.
Yeah, I mean, again, maybe I just don't give enough credit to stuff written, you know, almost 50 years ago now at this point. It comes to mind this whole idea of my favorite term that I seem to always come back to, like toxic masculinity, which is like this. Mm-hmm. It's like, how could a woman cheat on me of all people? Even though he is in the process of what he's doing, he's cheating on his wife with Desiree, and both of them know that that's what's going on, of course. But it's like, he is so comfortable in being like this person of well renown. Of course, I'd have a mistress, that he can't imagine someone else would cheat on him.
Well, and it was, I was listening this morning to the Now Later Soon episode, and you guys kind of touched on, you know, some of the subject matter and that being, you know, a little outdated at this point. But in like, you know, yeah, of course, like marital rape is not like the norm anymore.
Yeah, yeah.
But also, like, there are people who are still out there who are just scumbags. And like this kind of attitude is just like classic narcissist behavior. And in this situation, I don't know that it is like time period specific necessarily. It might not be like, it's not like, you know, King Louis's court where like the mistress to the king is a full-time salaried position that everyone, you know, that she, where she's like a big figure in court, you know, and that's a whole thing. But like, it still is kind of out there that like, well, I can cheat and like, I can be a man-ho. But if a woman has urges and desires outside of me, there's something wrong with her.
Yeah. No, for sure.
That sort of misogynistic line of thinking.
What I also love about this song in particular is that he is essentially creating almost an entire song of sentence fragments, which is like, he's just trying to like, she shouldn't be doing this. Like, so he's never really finishing the whole complete thought in any of these lines that he's singing. And yet it still all works together, which is really fun.
Yeah. Well, and I think it's, that kind of goes to that same thing that we were saying before, where he can't fathom where something like this would actually, like, he can't string a sentence together because to him, like, this is a completely unfathomable situation.
Right. Right.
So it's just like, it's, he doesn't have the words to like contextualize or articulate what's going on, because it's just not something that has ever occurred to him could happen.
You know what? It's not quite the same thing, but I'm going to blank on the sketch show. It's a British one, but there's the meme that goes around about that. The guy who's dressed up as like a Nazi and he like turns to his friend like, are we the baddies? That's kind of what it feels like to me. It's like, yeah, is it us? That's
a little bit. Yeah. Well, except that he never has that revelation.
Right. He never actually has that self-reflection. And even by the end of the show, he still does not have that self-reflection. So
he just like still is like thinks that this was all about him and he's so hard done by, and how could she, Charlotte? Like,
not to get political, but it'd be almost as if you couldn't accept the results of an election that happened.
What? That would never happen in any country, least of all the United States of America.
Now, I kind of prepared you for this, but this second kind of half of this lyric that I just read out has kind of taken me on a bit of a journey and a rabbit hole, because I don't know why it gets changed. So it goes, he'd never, therefore they haven't, which makes the question absolutely, could he? So that is how it is written in the Finishing the Hat book. So that's like the official lyrics from Stephen Sondheim himself. That is 100% how it is sung on the original Broadway cast album. However, the other two versions we're talking about here today, which I just realized I forgot to give credit to them. So just to go through that, Carl Magnus is sung by in the original Broadway cast by Laurence Guittard, who, fun little fact, plays Frederick in the 1995 version of it. In that 1995 version, though, Carl Magnus is played by Lambert Wilson. And then in the 2009 revival, it's Aaron Lazar. But why it's so interesting, that lyric, is that in both the 1995 version and the 2009 revival, they actually sing, could she?
Which makes the question absolutely, could she?
So they're flipping the pronoun to talk about Desiree instead of for Frederick. And I think that actually changes completely what this second half is. As it reads, for me at least, how the lyrics are written, he'd never, therefore they haven't. Okay, so which makes the question absolutely, then could she? So he's turning his attention now over to Desiree. I know he wouldn't do this, but would she do this? Where originally it's just he's always focused on Frederick in this situation. So I guess for you, what I'm really driving at here, which one do you prefer?
I've been thinking about that, and I think it makes more sense if it's could she, because as far as we know, these two men don't know each other.
Right.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. That's why they have the conversation right after this with Charlotte's wife. It's like, oh, go spy on them, or like go to Anne, who you kind of know from school.
Right. It's not like, this is my buddy, how could he do this to me?
Yeah.
like you don't know this guy. Maybe he 100% absolutely could, you know?
Yeah.
So I think it does make more sense. Although I just think it's strange that it, and it's published this way in Finishing the Hat and also in my, like the script that I have, like the libretto with the lyrics in it. It's the same way. So I can see, like, maybe it's like a question of honor. Like, you know, you would never take another man's woman because it's his property. And how dare you? I can see that side of the coin, but from like a character development standpoint, not that he has much of an arc, but in terms of his, you know, the meaningful relationships that he has already that we know about, I think she there makes more sense than he, but I'm not Stephen Sondheim, so what do I know?
Yeah, like I'm kind of there on the same page. I actually prefer the could she in that line, and I'm wondering, like, when it gets produced like regionally and stuff like that, whatever rights you're buying, you're probably singing the could he line in that way, but I wonder if like the new productions Sondheim is slipping in like do the could she. it makes a little bit more sense. I don't know how that all gets worked out, but I prefer the alternate way in this case.
I'm looking at the date that's on this script, because if it's a recent, because I honestly couldn't tell you when I got it. This is looks like 1991 edition, so it could very well have been updated since, you know, the last time it was edited.
Right.
I don't know. That's a good question.
So if any Sondheim scholars are out there who want to fill me in.
Or anyone who's done the show in the last 10 years.
Yeah, really. Maybe it's been updated since that time. However, Carl Magnus continues on, and this is where it kind of gets a little bit more lyrical, which is, fidelity is more than mere display. It's what a man expects from life. Fidelity like mine to Desiree and Charlotte, my devoted wife.
Fidelity is more than mere display. It's what a man expects from life. Fidelity like mine to Desiree and Charlotte, my devoted wife.
So it's a smaller section here, but anything you want to call out about that little lyric?
Just, it seems silly to point out the irony.
Right.
As, you know, he's a scumbag. That's
and I'm pretty sure, again, I'd have to probably rewatch either the movie version or a stage version. I think this is the first time we know that he is married himself, I think. So I think this is like the reveal in this song specifically. And I also think, again, production-wise, Sondheim writes about this, is that this song was in part written because they needed to do a scene change. So he just needed the song to be placed there so Hal Prince could like move the set around. And I think this lyric is what shows us, okay, now we're in Charlotte's room or in their place.
Yeah, that's what it says in the, they bring Charlotte on that line.
Yeah.
Charlotte, my devoted wife. Right here.
Right there. How convenient. It's also why in the movie version of A Little Night Music, they cut this song. So the song doesn't actually appear in it. But they have basically like the melody of this song playing as he like storms into his house. And then we see Charlotte and then they have their conversation sort of thing.
That's a thing they do a lot, I find, in musical adaptations, is they'll where they make a movie. A movie musical, or I guess a musical adaptation of a movie, whatever the correct terminology is, where if they're cutting songs or if there's a song that was already cut, they'll use it for transition music.
Yes.
The one I think about a lot is the Chicago movie, the song Me and My Baby, which isn't done in production. There's the they use as like scene transition.
Yeah.
Music in the movie, which I think it's a nice deep cut for the hardcore fans.
the most recent example I can think of, this is a little bit different because it started as a movie, became a Broadway musical, and then they made a movie, which is
it's from The Prom again, Kyle, I swear to God.
No prom. It's the Beauty and the Beast live action movie they did. They take the song Home, and they have that when they go into the library the first time, so they play the theme from Home.
There. So annoying, because that's such a good song.
It is. Like, honestly, if there's one song they should have included in that movie, they should have brought that in. But what last thing I just want to say Of course, there is like the life wife rhyme that we use in this one, which is like, your standard rhyme. But to rhyme display with Desiree actually is kind of a neat little rhyme choice that they decided to go with.
Yeah.
So Carl Magnus continues on. This is actually this is my favorite part, but I love that he gets so upset. So he says, the papers. He mentioned papers, some legal papers, which I didn't see there. Where were they? The goddamn papers she had to sign. What nonsense. He brought her papers. They were important, so we had to be there. I'll kill him. Why should I bother? The woman's mine.
The papers. He mentioned papers. Some legal papers, which I didn't see there. Where were they? The goddamn papers she had to sign. What nonsense. He brought her papers. They were important, so he had to be there. I'll kill him. Why should I bother? The woman's mine.
Besides, well, this side note, by the way, in the 1995 version in London, he doesn't say goddamn, he says bloody. So,
no,
but
no.
Still a kind of a swear that they can use. By the way, there's this section, and there's a section that we'll talk about later on in this song that, again, is a 16-year-old boy listening to this with no context about what the show is about. I'm like, I have no idea what is going on. And so what is he talking about? Papers.
Yeah, well, and what you miss on the cast recording, or on most cast recordings, I think they include the dialogue in the recording of the 2009 production.
Yes, they do.
But in between, like, Charlotte, My Devoted Wife, and this section, there's a big chunk of dialogue between him and Charlotte. And so, like, from here on, the rest of this song, he's, like, singing it to his poor wife.
Like, that's right. That's
right. She's responding to each section, and it's so vile. Like, they're, like, brainstorming together what could possibly be going on.
I know, because, I mean, the somewhat joke, but I always feel bad for Charlotte in this entire show, because, like, oh, I get 5 hours this week, because she knows he's off dallying with Desiree a little bit, and basically they concoct a scheme for her to go and talk to Anne and see, like, get some information on Frederick, and it's like, oh, great, that's what I'm going to get to do this weekend, because you're tired and you're going to go to bed, so I'm going to go do your dirty work for you.
Yeah, poor Charlotte.
I know. She does get one of the most heartbreaking songs, like, right after this one here, too.
So. God, I know. Although, I do prefer My Husband the Pig over Everyday a Little Death, but that's just a personal preference.
Well, we'll talk about that, because there's an interesting thing that happens in the 1995 version regarding this song, specifically.
Fun.
Which is, I guess we'll go there right now, because he sings, "Besides, no matter what one might infer, one must have faith to some degree. The least that I can do is trust in her the way that Charlotte trusts in me.
Besides, no matter what one might infer, one must have faith to some degree. The least that I can do is trust in her the way that Charlotte trusts in me."
So, in the 1995 version, right after that small section, they actually go to My Husband the Pig, and they sing actually the first half of that song.
Interesting.
So I think it's an interesting thing. And then they come back and sing the rest of In Praise of Women.
What am I, a prop to order about adulterer's low life? He seems to assume I have no life of my own. Well, he isn't alone. He bobs command and I'm suet. I don't understand how I do it. I have no objection to passing inspection, but who can contend with an endless erection that falls on its knees when it sees its reflection? My husband, the pig.
But I thought, what a neat way to bring in that cut song that actually does make dramatic sense.
Yeah.
And at least give Charlotte a little bit even more to do here in the first act, because she's, I think, largely forgotten in the second half of the show.
And she just, like, otherwise she's just kind of, like, standing there being abused and, like, being, like, a sounding board for this dirtbag.
I will talk more about My Husband the Pig in particular, because I'm going to be doing a whole episode again on the cut songs from this show. So we'll talk more about My Husband the Pig in that one. But just to finish this bit off, he continues to sing, "Capable, pliable women, undemanding and reliable, knowing their place. Insufferable, yes, but gentle. Their weaknesses are incidental. A functional but ornamental race.
Capable, pliable women. Women. Undemanding and reliable, knowing their place. Insufferable, yes, but gentle. Their weaknesses are incidental. A functional but ornamental race.
Oh, see, yeah, he doesn't think of women as humans. They're just a separate race entirely. Like just like an inferior being, like you think about your dog, like, right. Like it's so gross.
Well, yeah, the way that he talks about it, it's almost like, I don't know, some science fiction story where you're landing on a planet and like, ooh, like this weird like life form that I'm observing over here. Mm. It's like they're not quite human, but they're pliable and sometimes incidentally important into my life, sort of thing.
Right. Or like the way you would talk about like a beast of burden. Like I'm like, this is a nice specimen of a mule.
right.
It does what
good lineage,
functional,
good parentage, yeah.
Right. Like strong teeth shape. And legs, like slaps it on the rump. Good job, buddy. Like
that's right. Yeah.
Oh God.
The worst one for me is like pliable. Like what a weird thing. What a weird term to give to another human.
But, like, he's not wrong. Like, Charlotte does exactly what he wants her to do. Like,
yeah, true enough.
It's like a gross, disgusting, self-fulfilling kind of prophecy here where it's like he's, you know, and again, it's like, I'm not a psychologist or anything, but that's like classic narcissist behavior where you, like, manipulate the people around you to serve you.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And that's just another example of him doing that.
There is a bit of a weird rhyme scheme that Sondheim does here, because in the first stanza, it's just your ABAB rhyme, right? So it's like infer rhymes with her, degree rhymes with me. But then we go into this interesting one where it's like pliable rhymes with reliable, which is two lines later. Women and place don't rhyme, but place does rhyme with race, which is like the last word in that sentence. But we basically go ABAB sorta or ABAC sort of thing. And then we have three rhymes in a row, gentle, incidental, ornamental. So I don't know. It's kind of a weird structure that he's playing around with here.
It's like A, B, A, C, D, 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 C.
Yeah, that's the rhyme scheme he chose to do. Let's call it the Sondheim sonnet. That's what he's decided to do.
Well, and it's because it's more like a speech pattern than...
Yeah.
Writing lyrics, and it's and again, like a lot of this isn't complete sentences still, even though it does have a more lyrical feel to it. It's still just kind of thought fragments.
Yeah, they really are. Like this is like the thought fragments are there, and yet they are fitting into this interesting rhyme scheme at the same time. Yet he's mm-hmm. like, yeah, he is speaking full thoughts here in this case.
Yeah, and I know that we see him like speak in complete sentences in other places, so it's not, he's not like Donald Trump who just can't read or like
sure.
But you know, it is interesting in this song that's kind of like half internal monologue, half ranting out loud, that like in this emotional like heightened state he is not capable of stringing a complete sentence together.
About that, as we continue on this, another short section here has some of the, I think, the best like lyricism inside of it, which is durable, sensible, women, very nearly indispensable, creatures of grace. God knows the foolishness about them, but if one had to live without them, the world would surely be a poorer, if purer, place.
Durable, sensible, women. Very nearly indispensable creatures of grace. God knows the foolishness about them, but if one had to live without them, the world would surely be a poorer, if purer, place.
This is, he sounds so beautiful saying this stuff that is absolutely terrible.
Yeah.
For whatever reason, I've just always really loved that poorer but purer place. Like, there's just something about how those two words go together.
Mm-hmm.
That is very nice.
Well, and like, and that's the thing. And he does this, Sondheim does this shit on purpose, which, like, we love and hate about him, right? Like, he's like this beautiful lyric structure within the melody, the build through God knows the foolishness about them, and you kind of pull back, and then da 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 da, and but he's saying such shitty words.
That's right. Yeah, yeah.
And it's this like a complete juxtaposition that if you understand that Carl Magnus's behavior is scumbaggy, you're like, oh yeah, God, what a scumbag. But if like, if you kind of are a Carl Magnus, like it like, you're like, oh yeah, this guy knows what's up, and it all kind of works together for you.
Well, this brings us to the last section here, and this is the section I was kind of referencing beforehand.
But which you, is, you mean 15-year-old Kyle didn't know what a hip bath was?
So again, to put this into context for people who might not be able to figure this out, like I think we got the internet later on when I was 16, maybe early 17. Anyways, I lived on a farm. Like and even with the internet, it was dial up. It was slow.
So did
slow.
You have so a hip bath? Like,
I did not have a hip bath. But like, this is like, it makes absolutely no sense when you have no idea what the plot of the show
right,
actually is.
Like,
what is he like, talking about? Yeah. But this is what he actually says. These are the actual lyrics. The hip bath, about that hip bath. How can you slip and trip into a hip bath? The papers, where were the papers? Of course he might have taken back the papers. She wouldn't, therefore they didn't. The woman's mine.
The hip bath, about that hip bath. How can you slip and trip into a hip bath? The papers, where were the papers? Of course he might have taken back the papers. She wouldn't, therefore they didn't. The woman's
like this entire like half of this lyric is talking about a hip bath. I'm like,
yeah.
I don't even know what a hip bath
what
is.
Hip
like,
bath? What's
yeah?
But I think the line like, how can you slip and trip into a hip bath? Like, I feel like you could, but you would make a big mess and like probably hurt yourself.
for those of you who may not know, like, I think they call them, they don't really call them hip baths anymore. I think they call them a standing bath.
It's a sits bath.
Or yeah, sits bath. Yeah. Type thing. Yeah. Which is,
well, and it
yeah,
has a different
it's like a
function
small jacuzzi
now.
Sort of thing, right?
Like, I Googled it. That's kind of what they look like. It's like a, because it used to be like, that's just how you took a bath before running water. But now it's like, if you have hemorrhoids and want relief for them, you can use the sits bath for that. Mm-hmm. It's like a different kind of, it's evolved a little bit.
Right. Yeah. But yes, in the movie version of A Little Night Music, you do see like the hip bath as a prop. And it's like up to, I don't know, Frederick's like chest area. So it, like, yeah, okay, I can see why Carl Max is getting a little bit suspicious. Like, you can't really,
like, you're not going to submerge.
Yeah, no.
Like, your whole entire clothes won't be sopping wet.
No, like, at most, like, your sleeve or something.
Right.
Might be,
but it's like the, like, old-timey Victorian. Yeah, because, like, you're not, unless you fall, like, ass first into the tub. Like, and even then, it's just going to be the ass part that's wet.
Right.
So it is a little suspect. Or, as I learned this from a young person, sus.
It's sus. Yes, that's right. This podcast is always on the bleeding edge of like being relevant for the young people.
Gen Z terms and slang and things.
That's right. How do you feel about the ending of the song though? Like, is how do you like this last section?
I think because he also says, of course, he might have taken back the paper. So I think he's like trying to kind of talk himself off the ledge a little bit. Like, because this is, how can you slip and trip into a hip bath? Of course, he might have taken back the papers. Like, he's like, well, he's kind of hedging on it now. And like, maybe nothing's really going on. Although we never do actually see any papers, because of course, there aren't any papers. But
that's right.
But I think he is trying to kind of pull back a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because they have the conversation about like, oh, you should go visit Anne.
Yes.
Before this last section of the song.
They do.
So he already is kind of doing something about it. So maybe he's just trying to like stop himself from having an aneurysm or something. I don't know.
That's like, right. That's right. I think what this leads to is this a quick broader conversation of the Carl Magnus character, which, I mean, they do a pretty good job basically replicating what the character's like in the original Bergman film, because he is this pompous kind of asshole in that film version too, where he's like this military guy and everything, you know, deserves to come to me sort of thing. Although, as Sondheim writes too, there was another cut song that was supposed to be here called Bang.
It's so good.
Which actually takes, not verbatim, but basically the speech that he gives in that original film about like making love is like making war. Mm-hmm. So it was like that, that you could have done, which is kind of too bad that that isn't brought more into, I think, these lyrics too, a little bit.
Yeah.
Yeah, because
it's a complete gear shift from, and like sometimes when he is substituting songs out, the one that goes, like the new one that goes in will have like something in common thematically with the one that was removed, but that's just not the case here.
Right, because the, is it Every Day a Little Death? Yeah, Every Day a Little Death.
Mm-hmm.
That lyric was actually originally in that My Husband the Pig, which he took from there and then put into a whole new song, essentially.
Mm-hmm.
So there's things that he likes to take out and like rearrange into where they need to go to.
Yeah, he's like, fine, you're going to make me give you a new song, okay, but you're going to get a cannibalized version of this one that I already wrote.
Actually, before I forget about it too, My Husband the Pig has very similar energy, I find, to Funny Thing Happened, that dirty old man from from Forum. It's very similar, I feel, when you listen back to it.
It's kind of a patter song.
Yeah.
Words are hard. Yeah, it does kind of have that same vibe of like, oh, look, my husband's a scumbag. Great.
But I guess coming back to my original question, which is, like, what function do you see Carl Magnus actually being in this story? Like, as far as adaptation go, yes, he's in the original film. But do you think he's like integrated well into this plot?
Well, so, okay, I haven't seen the movie because I'm a bad person, but at least in this context, he's kind of the catalyst for everything that unfolds after this point, because he doesn't send Charlotte to like egg Anne into going to the weekend in the country, and then Charlotte doesn't come back and tell him about the weekend in the country, and then he doesn't like ruin Charlotte's birthday by going like storming in uninvited to this party. Like, none of that happens, and then like none of the ridiculous shenanigans ensue.
I guess that's interesting. Like, yeah, what you consider to be like the true inciting action, but I like that, because like if Carl Magnus had just like calmed down by a magnitude of like 5 or 6 degrees, it's like it's fine. Like everything is cool. Like this was just a fling, anyways.
Right.
But I think because he like pulls on that thread a little bit too hard, Weekend in the Country happens, and eventually Desiree and Frederick decide that they are going to spend life together.
Right. So it's a whole snowball or dominoes effect, I guess. Yeah.
Self-fulfilling prophecy is what I would call it a little bit.
Like, okay, so we're doing this.
I still to this day, every version I've listened to, that woman's mind, that note is pure bliss to me. I love that high note that they end the song on. Do they earn it? I don't know, but it's like, I just love that that's how they decide to end this, like declaratively, like this woman is mine.
It's very
Gaston.
She
isn't. That's the Gaston moment for sure. But yeah, where would you rate this, I guess, in relation to the entire rest of the score?
So I think it does a really good job, even though, you know, it's like Sondheim says, it's not nearly as interesting as Bang, but it does a good job of kind of showing us who Carl Magnus is, of like giving us a, you know, showing us his character instead of like having the people around him talking about what a scumbag he is, or just like having conversations with his wife to demonstrate that he's a scumbag. You know, he has this song that does what musical numbers, you know, do, while like, you know, moving the plot forward, but also giving us some insight into his character. So I think it's a good song in that respect. Overall, within like the world of the show, you know, the songs that make it into the show, it's not one of my favorites, just because like he is a scumbag and there are songs that I think are much more interesting in the show. But I think it is a good kind of, it's kind of like kicking a rock off the top of the hill and like starting all of the downward momentum that comes next.
Yeah, I think I'm pretty close to you there. Like, it's definitely not in my top half of the songs that are in this show. It's not the one I would probably return to. As a function in the show, it definitely works. Like they say, like, this is kind of where you need to do your scene change. So there has to be something there on stage to help like facilitate that as that's happening in the background. But as far as like adaptation goes, with I keep going back to this, but like the film version of A Little Night Music, I think there's a reason why they cut this song, because you get everything you need from the quick conversation that him and Charlotte have. You don't really need to have that song in that place,
right?
Because you kind of get it from that conversation. So I get it. This is the last time I'll mention it, I swear. But going back to the prom, there is there's like that promposal song that happens.
Yeah.
It's like, this is a scene change song. And you can kind of tell because this really serves no function in the larger plot of this movie that's going on. So, you can kind of see like how different people approach these types of songs when it comes to filming them.
And it's interesting because if you look at like the original sequence, you have In Praise of Women, or no, In Praise of Women would be instead of Bang. So like you have Liaisons and that goes straight to Bang. And then My Husband, the Pig, and then A Weekend in the Country. And I feel like that way there's a lot of, like, we don't need a whole like 7 minute song to show us that like Desiree doesn't actually want to have sex with Carl Magnus. You know, like,
right.
Like that's, you know, and I feel like the way that it ended up does a better job of putting the plot into the lyrics of the songs rather than stopping the plot to sing and then continuing the plot with book scenes. So I think that as much as I think Bang is a much more fun and interesting song, and I like My Husband the Pig, it's a more fun and interesting song, I think like from a narrative standpoint, the way that the structure ended up is probably better.
One other thing I guess I like to know about, this is my own prejudice that's coming out here, so push back if you don't agree with this. What I found now, having revisited this show, watching the original movie, seeing the film version, watching a few productions that are actually on YouTube that you can watch of this show that are somewhat, they're professionally filmed even, is I find like the first act of this musical is like A plus for me, and then the act two comes on and it feels so rushed. There's like four songs that happen in there, and like everything just happens, and then we're kind of resolved, and we're and the curtain comes down type of thing. So it's like A plus first act one, and then for me it's like a B minus act two. Even though Sending the Clowns is great and there's some good stuff in there, it's just like, I don't know if you feel the same way, if this is a weirdly like unbalanced show when it comes to act one, act two.
Unbalanced is exactly the word I was thinking of too. And it's so strange because like it's like you said, act two is chock full of beautiful, beautiful songs. Like Miller's Son is one of my favorites. Yeah. It's like I did a whole thing on that song in college, and like it's like still one of my go-to audition pieces. Like I love that song.
Right.
But like the whole Petra subplot, like it's like an already very busy show.
Right. Yeah.
I don't know. Like, and I see like thematically the like don't waste your life kind of like message that we're getting from her. Like I see how that applies and like how that message is relevant to the A plot of the show, but I don't know. I feel like there's a lot of, it's like you said, like it's just like we go into act two with a lot of loose ends already. And then we create even more loose ends. And then there's like kind of a rush to wrap everything up as neatly as it's going to be wrapped up.
Right. Yeah. There's some,
like we don't all have
these
like,
people are going to be deeply damaged for years to come.
But yeah, I agree. It does feel a little lopsided in that way.
Well, Adrianna, thank you so much for joining me here today. If people wanted to, you know, keep following what you're up to, is there a way to do so online?
Yeah, I am on Twitter and Instagram as Mrs. Will Shakes, like as in William Shakespeare is my husband. Mm-hmm. And not the gentleman who received the coronavirus vaccine in England, whose name happened to also be William Shakespeare.
That's true. Yeah.
It's mostly pictures of my dogs on Instagram, and I think I post on Twitter like twice a year. But if you want to see cute puppies or rehearsal photos from shows that I was in when we were still allowed to do shows, they're all on Instagram.
Perfect. Thank you so much.
Thank you for having me, Kyle.
Thank you for listening. You can send emails to puttingittogetherpodcast@gmail.com. You can also follow Sondheim Podcast on Twitter and Instagram. And you can support the show on Patreon by going to patreon.com/puttingittogetherpodcast. Thank you to the Alberta Podcast Network and to Park Power this week. Putting It Together is available on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, and pretty much anywhere you can get podcasts from. Consider subscribing so that you never miss an episode. Next week, we'll be talking about Every Day a Little Death, also known as The Last 2 Weeks. As always, a big thanks to the great Chris Taniguchi, who designed the podcast artwork, and Nick Driscoll for composing our theme music. Well, we've reached the end of our episode. Yes, I know. Goodbye for now.
Why don't you pay a visit to Marta's little school friend?
Aha!
She probably has no idea what her husband's up to.
And I could enlighten her. Ah, well, if I'm back in 2 hours, that still leaves us 3 hours, right?
You're a good wife, Charlotte. The best.
That's a comforting thought to take with me to town, dear. Just may keep me from cutting my throat on the tram.